Hello. Well, this is a bit. I like a lot the genetic algorithms. Probably you already know about them. And I want to show some experiments I did. I am Xiao Coder, or Jesus Olmos. Yes, my name is Jesus. I work in Fox IT, doing Intel, reversing malware and. ¿Cómo va esto, tío? Hey. I work in malware analysis, and also I did a pen test for many years. But I have to say that I'm not an artificial intelligence expert, but I like a lot this topic. This is Darwin, and the genetic algorithms are a technology to evolve constants. But I used the genetic algorithms in another way in order to evolve code instead of data structures. The typical is, for example, you have an algorithm, and this algorithm has three constants. These constants, you can do brute force, depending on the algorithm, you can do brute force to find out the optimal values for that constants. If there are many constants, you can do not brute force, but there are other approaches, like genetic algorithms, to evolve a set or a combination of constants. But what happens if the code is not optimal? You can find the optimal constants for a code that is not optimal. So in this case, what I decided was creating the code automatically. I like to automate everything, and one thing difficult to automate is automation. Imagine a magic box from the future that generates automatically code. There are several approaches for doing that. One approach would be providing all the details. For example, talking with the magic box, providing every details. But this is similar to programming. It's more interesting the second approach, that is instead of providing the details, providing a purpose. Which is a evaluation function. Well, in the past, I did I hear myself. I did a trading algorithm that has two functions, the sell function and the buy function, but these functions are empty. And the software creates automatically code and is evolving that code in order to evolve and creating a strategy automatically. Well, in fact, it evolved and converged, and it starts generating code automatically. For example, in this case, in the early generations, it starts to making operations. And for example, a simple mutation in an operator changes a lot the algorithm itself, and this algorithm start losing money, but with the time, with the generation, was evolving, and well, it it demonstrates that it's possible to evolve code, and this for some situation is useful. And I decided to port to Radare the static evaluations and the code displays, and also it's possible to evolve ASIL code. Well, this can be designed in many different ways. In this case, the genotype holds the code, the binary code. The population is a group of genotypes, and the genotype is sent to the sandbox. Well, what? Well, now? Hola? The genotype is sent to a sandbox. The sandbox do a fork, and the genotype is executed in the real processor. For most of the problems, it's better to use emulation for safety execution and better evaluation. But I launch the code in the sandbox. What? Vale, vale. No problem. Well, I generate 100 of assembly codes randomly. The initial set is random, and I send them to a sandbox. Well, a sandbox is controlling the set files, timeouts, and so on. And the code is executed, evaluated, and a score is stored in the genotype. But what is the typical? The typical that people do is storing the genotype only one float, for example, with the final score. But for tracking evolution, it's better to store more scores, more information about the evaluation of each sample. Well, at the beginning, I implemented the R2 pipe in each genotype, but this is not a good idea. It's better to doing only one R2 pipe instance and share the pointer. For example, the sandbox. The sandbox definition is very pretty straightforward. Just running genotypes and evaluating it and storing the information in the genotype. The chill process. What does basically is avoid the seq fouls, implement a timeout, because the evaluation function, if I want to evolve the code to make a CPU load, for example, I want to make a code that in 4 seconds load the CPU. This will evolve to an infinite loop. So you have to put a penalty for a timeout for avoiding infinite loops in the code, because it's quite common. I do the evaluation from the child process and send via pipe the score. The parent process in the sandbox, what does is, well, controlling the crashes, the different possible crashes, and also control the timeout. The scoring system, you can implement the evaluation function as you want. This is a base, a kind of software that you can customize the evaluation function. In this case, I'm giving a score, for example, a score 0 if crash, score 1 if there is a timeout, and if the code sends properly, it sends 2 or more score. What is this? I read from the pipe the score, but one thing important is that the pipe, I have to implement another alarm, another timeout for the reading the pipe, because there's a kind of risk condition depending the terminating of the process could freeze the pipe and the read is blocking and, well. The sandbox, It's not safe, really, but I put the code. I put a return of pulse. If I don't put the return, it will learn by itself to end with a return. But if we know that the last instruction must be a return, if we know part of the solution, we can hardcode this part of the solution to help the learning. Learning not from zero, learning help the learning. And I put a sig trap pool, but really it's not the code. If one jumps to outside and can control the evaluation function. But. Well, mutation in genetic algorithms is not good to do a lot of mutation because can convert the algorithm in a random search. One thing I do is starting with a more or less high mutation, but with the generations, I reduce gradually the mutation because a high mutation is more path exploration and low mutation is more optimization, and the crossover is a more accurate way of mutation. We can mutate the bytes randomly, but it's more efficient to implement a logic. Depending on the codes, you mutate in one way or another way, different probabilities. It's not the same probability for modifying an operand and modifying the opcode. Or depending, there are opcodes that we have to ban, for example, or other opcodes we want to increase the score, for example, on more probability. The crossover, now I'm doing a byte level crossover. For example, if we have this is one code, another code. Right now the length is fixed, and with these two, for example, the father and the mother, we can generate 16 childs. And for example, one child could be the first block of the father, the second block of the mother, the third block of the father, and the fourth block of the mother. There are 16 combinations, and this is the crossover. But, well, you know, probably we are cutting here in assembly instructions. And it's probably it's not the most effective way to more efficient way to do the crossover. But with this crossover also learns. An instruction level crossover. The thing is that don't cut instructions. And the problem of doing instruction level crossover is that the childs can have different lengths because every instruction in CISC we are different lengths, so the code can mutate also the amount of bytes. But this is not bad. Another possibility is basic block level mutation crossover. For example, there are instructions that semantically must not be divided. For example, or other yes, depending the situation and depending the logic. And this was wonderful because I was passing the bytes to get the array of with the length of the instruction, but there is a command to do that. So I don't know who developed this command, but it was cool. Well, the evaluation function is the key, because depending the evaluation, the code will converge or not. Imagine we have a labyrinth, and we have an error. The error rate, well, I am assuming the error rate is like, for example, 0 is very well, 0.5 is so-so, and 1 is bad. But the scoring is the opposite. No, the more score is the better. In this case, imagine that we have an indicator which is the distance between our position and the solution. And we are here. What will happen? Well, this evaluation function give us a clue, but it's not very well. We can solve the labyrinth with this evaluation function, but it's not very good, really. But what will happen is that it will check the distance, and we will hear in the next generation, the next generation we will hear, then start to passing a lot of generations, and thanks to the mutation, when they arrive here, and thanks to the evaluation function, when they arrive here. And mathematically, it's a good result because we are very near to the solution. But in this case, it's not. I'm showing this because I want to explain a very important concept, which is really we don't have one sample, we have 1,000 samples or 1,000 samples. In this case, we have 6 samples, and we evaluate these. And regarding this evaluation, the 3 best samples would be these 3 regarding this evaluation. So, but we also keep the diversity. Keeping the diversity means that for the next generation, not only pass these 3, we'll pass also one of these 3, for example, this one. And this one, with this, keeping the diversity, there is the possibility to cross over this with this, generating a child here and here. And if we are here, what we will see is that the population divides a bit, and we will have, at the beginning we will say, very good, we are evolving a lot, but these 3 will stagnate a bit at the end. But if we not only see the fitness of the best, we also see the average, the average, because we will see really is moving. If this is here with mutation and keeping the diversity in several generations, more mutation is more exploration, and will be here. In the moment this arrive here, thanks to the evaluation function, this will evolve. What we will see is that it's evolving very well. The evolution stops. There is a trick that when the evolution is stopping, we increase the mutation. And when we see that the is evolving again, we stop the mutation. So here there is a lot of mutation, and we'll see that at the beginning this evolves, stops the evolution, and continues the evolution of the brush, and solves the problem. Well, there is another way that is implementing another evaluation function. Most of the problems, there are paths that are known. For example, in the code, for example, this could be a segfault, and this could be a infinite loop. So we can implement penalties. We can implement several ifs in the evaluation function to help to drive the evolution a bit. I do two evaluations, a dynamic evaluation and a static evaluation. The dynamic evaluation is executing the code in the processor and checking some stats, depending the purpose. In this case, I'm checking the OOM, the CPU a lot. I want to increase these values to produce a kind of denial of service in less than 4 seconds, but I don't want to increment the OOM because the process can be finished by the kernel. It's just an experiment. I implement penalties for avoiding fouls and timeouts and so on. But there is also a static evaluation that performs very well because we can prevent to execute a code that we know that don't get will not be a valid code, for example. Thanks to Radar, we will detect the out-of-scope branches. We can detect the invalid instructions, and all the analysis features of Radar can be used to prevent, to speed up the evaluation. Well, yeah, when we finish the evaluation and we have a sample that I didn't explain other. There is another way that is implementing several test cases. Do you know the test-driven programming? For example, if we have 10 cases, this generates a code automatically that passes all the cases. If we do a... there are people that say in the future, we'll program only the tests, and the code will be generated automatically. And the test not represents all the scope of possible results of the code, but in some situations, yes. Well, the validation basically is that when we end the execution and we have the perfect sample, we use this in another data set of to validate that if not, we have to start again to evolve from zero. Okay, but in which situation we can use this? Genetic algorithms are great, and I think we could use more this technology in other things. For example, the typical things are search problem and optimization problems. Do you think that could be used for detecting vulnerabilities? For example, we could check a code. We can evaluate a code and decide the distance from the code to the solution. How near is the code from triggering the vulnerability? It's not easy. If you can do this evaluation function, probably, for example, or writing partially registers, or we can do a set of heuristics to score how near we are from the exploiting a vulnerability. But well, I didn't try it. The R2 wars, I did some calculations, and in a computation of 1 year, one PC could generate the perfect warrior. Well, it would be funny, humans versus versus artificial intelligence. But local DOS is what I was trying. Well, I'm still trying. Local DOS is generating assembly code that measure all the system resources in order to evolve to the maximum system consume. The remote DOS, well, the remote DOS is instead of mutating code, we can mutate network packets and install a sensor in the remote host and evaluate with the resources of the host. Well, I will do a demo. I launched the software. It's developed in C++, and this has generated 100 of samples, evaluated them, and in the first generation we have one code that reaches a 22 fitness, which means that doesn't stack fault, doesn't. It seems incredible because there are some jumps. If it has this scoring, means that doesn't crash it and doesn't time out, finish the execution properly. So, let's see next generations. Right now it's not evolving. In the first generation, it's same code. The nice thing is running this during hours and see the evolution. But in this case, we have this code give a bit more fitness than this. It's based, it's similar, it has some similarity. Well, right now, the evaluation function that I'm doing is very basic. For example, I'm not nopping or removing the malleable instructions, and there are more things that I could do, and I'm still with this. Well, this is a little example about this. This is recorded because it takes a lot of time. In this case, I am using too much mutation, but for this specific problem, I had to use that mutation. Well, in the sixth generation, it makes several operations. And it starts. Here it starts losing money because it starts with 3,000, and with the generation is losing less money every time. So there is an evolution. So it's optimizing a strategy, but in fact the same strategy in different moments. It's just an experiment. And another experiment I did in Rust. Well, it's similar than the previous, but but developed in Rust instead of interpreted code, emulated code. I have the interpreted code evolver, the emulated code evolver, and the assembly code with the real processor. Well, some public resources in my GitHub. And well, thanks for your attention.
Questions?
Questions?
No. Okay, so thanks.
Okay.